Hello, I'd like to talk with you today, or probably rather talk to you today, about projected and fluid identities, and that in altered, or with a subtitle, Altered Entities in Technology Mediated Spaces. So, what does that mean? It means I want to talk about how body images, identity patterns, and the way we perceive ourselves, or we perceive somebody else as a whole, as an entity, can be changed, altered, transformed, or projected or changed through the use of technology. And more specifically, that means that I would like to show to you a few techniques that I developed in pieces that I've been developing over the past few years, which make use of technology and which kind of exemplify certain alterations in how we look at a human being. And I've prepared four different subcategories which align to four works that I created, and I want to exemplify each of those headlines very briefly with a piece. So the four parts I would like to talk about are projection, control, fluidity, and transformation of body perception or body images or identity models, so to say. And maybe before we dive into, I can give like one general remark about the pieces I'll talk about, or the way I've been approaching to write or to compose or to structure the most recent pieces that I worked on. And that is that I see them kind of as kind of experimental settings, or kind of as test scenarios that let us, and us in that case means me, means the performers, and means the audience, that let us learn something, that let us find out something, and in the pursuit of insight or knowledge. So, of course, every artwork is an experiment, is trying out. But I really mean it in the way that a lot of these pieces are more, it's more like a structured setting with rules and with certain possibilities that can happen. And then what the artwork really is, or what comes out of it, is only determined in the process and through the interaction with the people. And so it means it can go in different directions. The outcome can be different, and the outcome varies significantly between different persons who interact with these artworks. So, yes. So that's it. And so, maybe a second very general thing I can say about these works, and also about the use of technology, is that there may be two different aspects in the use of technology. One is to investigate or look at what technology does to our body perceptions, to our way of interacting or communicating. So that's the one side. And the other side is, how can we use technology as a metaphor to illustrate or to exemplify or to look at patterns of interaction or of cognition, maybe even, that are inherent in the way we communicate and interact without the use of technology. So also taking technology as a tool to find out something about us. And actually, that is the part that interests me more, even though both sides are in those pieces. And so technology here can function sort of as a mirror, kind of throwing something back that is already in us. And maybe you also realize that often when you talk about implications or possibilities of technology, you very quickly come back to what you are, or what the possibilities or limitations of a human being are. And so in this kind of in this way of thinking, it kind of functions as a mirror, so to say. And this is why I gave a subtitle to the talk, which is that it's in reference, or that it takes mirror neurons as a reference. So the things I'm doing here are not neuroscientific and are not using mirror neurons, but the idea of what mirror neurons do, that you kind of have this mirroring opponent and you kind of follow what the other person is doing on several small levels, and through that have the possibility to kind of connect, to understand, and to feel empathetic about, or to sympathize with a opposing entity. That is something I find interesting. So, and I just took out a few catchwords of what mirror neurons can do, because I find them so motivating. So, which goes from allowing empathy, self-awareness, automatic imitation, mimicry, theory of mind, kind of trying to understand or being able to understand what the other person thinks, and sex-based differences. So it's also, we'll see some of the things have to do with body alterations. And that also means kind of going into the skin of another human being. All right, so much for a general introduction. And now I'll give four very brief examples of pieces that I wrote, or even writing is not that I constructed might maybe be the more appropriate wording. So first one is transfer of body, transfer of your own entity, of your own self-perception. I did that in a few pieces, and one of them has the title Unity Switch. So in that piece, you are equipped with a camera that has a video screen in it, a headset that has a video screen in it. So you basically just see a screen, and it also has a camera mounted to it, which captures everything you see. The same happens on an auditory level with microphones and headphones. So basically, in the starting point, you see what you would normally see, but through headphones and through a screen. So you kind of see like a technology mediated version of what you would normally see. As the piece starts, what I need to say is that there are four rooms, and in each of the rooms, there are two people sitting in front of each other wearing this kind of equipment. And as the piece then goes on, you start to kind of switch between person to person or room to room. So it means after the initial starting, you start seeing through the eyes of another participant, or you might see through the eyes of another performer. So you jump from room to room, from person to person, from identity to identity. And in this case, it works in a way that the participants are invited to synchronize their movements with the person with whom they are switching perspective. So it is here, it's kind of about the synchronicity between people, giving you the illusion that you are being controlled, or you are controlling, but or that you are kind of inside of another human being. So here we see a few images of Unity Switch, and now I'll play you a very short excerpt of the video documentation. So far in all its briefness. So It's like I already said, it's about the sensation of body switching and synchronicity between different bodies. And it gives you the possibility to accept another body as your own. And it has a surprising amount of body immersion that can be realized. So a related piece that uses a comparable setup, but deals more with questions of control, is the piece Genesis. And here you kind of see like an illustration waiting screen, so to say. Genesis is a it's an online computer game, if you want, and it's a real-life virtual computer game. So what does that mean? It means there's a big empty hall, the one that you see in front of you here. And within that hall, there are four human performers, which are there around the clock for 7 days. So it's an installation that runs for 7 days nonstop. And the four performers, which are called avatars, are wearing, again, a headset with a microphone and with a camera attached to it. And like that, they are capturing everything that they would see from the first person perspective. So it means somebody else could look through the eyes of those human avatars. And this is exactly what happens in that game, so to say, or in that experiment, because the audience is able to log in through a browser interface for 1 hour slots and play with the human avatars as if they were a computer game character. So what you see here is kind of the starting moment of what you would see if you would play the game. You see the human hands that are waiting for instruction. So you as a player then could tell the avatar what to do. And with a few exceptions, the human avatar will carry out everything that you say, but will not speak back to you, but will only give you very basic messages through an arm interface. And it also displays whether the character you're controlling is hungry, thirsty, sleepy, or is warm or cold. So you have a very reduced representation of a human body, of a human entity. And you are then, there are no rules, you're completely free to do whatever you want to do. So it's kind of, there's no, like I said a bit in the beginning, thinking of this, of something like an experimental setting. Here we are basically observing what the people feel, do, want to do. So how do they relate to this very virtual representation of a human being? What do they want to build within this strange virtual world? Because this big industry hall, nobody ever sees it. There are no, and it starts off completely blank. There's nothing in it. No light, no chair, no hammer, no nothing. But you, through an inventory, you can slowly put things in it and kind of create a world. So here we see one of the avatars, the performer Carola Schaal, in this case, with the headgear on. And I'll play to you a very short video clip that shows a few possible interactions that happened within the piece.
Explore the person. Explore the arms with your hands.
These are the things that I ordered and that we can use now.
Take a photo of the machine.
All right. So you may imagine that there's a lot of documentation material that we recorded in 7 days, and there's a lot of information around that, which is impossible to cram into this presentation now. We've also did a questionnaire, and there was also a musicologist writing a very thorough report on the piece, which is all available online, which might feel like an excessive load of documentation. But if you think of it, or I like to think of it in a way that designing the piece is just preparation, and how the 7 days run is like half of what the piece is. And the other half is the kind of the observation, or the kind of looking through the results and looking what people felt within it. And so this range was very wide, from people abusing control to people feeling very empathetic towards the human avatars and caring for them, making sure that they feel right. And the overall actions range from destruction to a very constructive world building, so to say. But there was boredom, there was excitement, there was unease. So it displayed a wide range of how people would react or feel in this situation. And maybe what we can say is that what the player perceives of the human avatar is kind of a very reduced version of what a human being is. You basically see a pair of hands, and you have a status bar that says whether the person you are controlling wants to sleep or wants to drink something. So it's a very minimal description of what a person is. And to kind of look at what such a reduced portrayal of a person allows or doesn't allow is one of the core questions within that piece. And that brings me to the next example I want to talk about, which is fluidity. And it's kind of continues to take the idea of a parametric version of a human a bit further, and uses artificial intelligence to scan in humans, in this case the musicians of the Ensemble Resonance, scan them in with audio and with video, and then create kind of alternate or interpolated or transformed versions of these human musicians. So without going into technical detail, we used video and audio data, trained deep learning networks on it, and then with this network we're able to generate new voices, new playing techniques, and new facial expressions and playing techniques. So for one, maybe the important part is that this generative model then is able to generate things that have not been there before. And it kind of, you still see the original musicians, but you see how their faces morph and become, let's say, more female, more male, older or younger, with more body hair, and the expression changes. So it kind of takes these entities, which is the ensemble, and kind of liquefies them, and starts to kind of wobble around what their center identity normally would be. And I'll say a few words more about that after we watched a very brief excerpt of a online video version of that piece.
That is the definition of such a model. No. don't see these sliders. These values. These adjustment dials. That they can move into our consciousness. Through illness. Hallucination. Through drugs. Through psychotic states. Computation processes.
Okay, maybe that's a good moment to stop. If you listen to the kind of the different examples of what can change the way we look at an entity or how we look at a model, here computation processes is the or technology is the kind of the last example, but the other ones are through other processes that are more that are mental, that are that happen in the brain, which are naturalistic occurring. So here kind of goes back a bit to the idea of saying using technology as a metaphor for things that are happening in us as well, kind of putting them out there, making them obvious, kind of exemplifying them. So the through the use of autoencoders in that in the technology in that piece, it means that we kind of take a take a face, a human being, and describe it in a model in a parametric fashion. So what does that mean? It means we kind of again reduce the amount of information of how we describe a person. Not through millions of pixels, which are the cells or the color points in the way we look, but rather through higher concepts of whether I'm wear facial hair or whether I have a long nose or whether I have blue eyes or not. So it's, and what I find interesting is here and also for the next piece I'll talk about is the question of categorization. Things that we do, that a computer here, that is the definition of what a computer does in that case. It tries to categorize and then regenerate. And but we humans do the same thing. And so what this technology here does, and this is kind of what the communication within that piece is about between musicians and this technology is, looking at the fluidity or at the fact that to make that these models are constructive. So they are not God-given, they're not absolute. They do only exist in the modeling that we do in our brain or that a machine does. And that those things are not fixed, but can be altered, can be transformed, can be liquefied. And and that maybe is kind of true for all these pieces where I see, of course, it contains a lot of negative or critical aspects to it too, and kind of like weird and scary things. But it also has, at least a notion of potential for emancipation from fixed models, from to say the way we look at other people is a is a model that we have of them, or how we look at ourselves. And one possibility of technology in that case is to kind of make that, to bring that across. And that's something I find interesting. And last one, that is a kind of in a similar domain, deals explicitly with transformation, not so much of liquefying, but more of really transformation or recreating identities. And it's a project called Crawlers, which runs on Facebook. And there's that's a collection of bots, which which have Facebook accounts and befriend people, chat with people. But mostly what they do is they download all the data from the people they're friends with. So all information, all images, all text, all posts, all everything, put it into a database, transform all this information by finding an profile image that almost looks like you, by rewriting all your texts that they are almost true, but not quite. And doing that with every information and creating alternate profiles of you. And once the process is done, you'll get a message from one of the bots, and you'll get a link to your new profile. And this process right now, I think there are how many are there? I think like 200,000 or 300,000 posts and images and so on, and really a lot of profiles that have been scanned and been duplicated. So here we see, for example, on the left, an original post, and on the right, a recreated post. So you can see it's like almost the same, but not really. So it's, I think I had prepared a few more. They don't show up here, but yeah. So here's another example. If you go to crawlers.net, and crawlers is written with a 3 instead of a E, then you basically see, you can check them out all yourselves, and chances are that you find your own profile there as well. So here, it's slightly different. It has this kind of this notion, well, not really notion, but it kind of has this data security aspect of it, this kind of stealing of private information. So because it also takes things that you only share privately with your friends, and it makes everything of that public, but it also changes the way you are represented, which might be, you might find that really funny, you might find that scary, you might find that off-putting, or some people said, well, I like my new profile more than I like my original life. So you can again see there's a wide range of how people relate to this. And here, of course, it plays a bit with how you represent yourself and this kind of this brand that you construct out of yourself. And through warping all of that, it kind of makes you, hopefully in the best case, maybe reconsider this process, makes you reconsider how you see yourself, and maybe also again, how another version of you could be possible. Or maybe some things are more extreme or weird in that case, and it's meant as an impulse to maybe think about what your personal representation looks like. And that's actually all I wanted to show as examples. And as a summary, well, I tried to explain to you how I like to think of artworks as kind of experimental settings, or as like test scenarios that let you investigate something, and then gives the performers or the audience actually the chance to experience themselves what it means and what they take out of it. And I introduced the idea of using technology as a mirroring tool, as something that kind of that reflects back what we are and how we look at ourselves or at somebody else, but kind of like a warp mirror, like a mirror that changes something or kind of also exposes the way how our identities might be constructed or might be just internal representations. And linked with that are questions of manipulation of truth and of identity. And that, of course, can be and is, as you all know, abused in a lot of cases with fake information, with a warping of truth and so on and so forth. But maybe in the artwork, we can also see it as a kind of liberation tool, as in to see how to, let's say, bring back into consciousness how non-absolute we are, you are, and we all are. And that's what I wanted to share with you. Thanks for listening.